Michael to start the webinar on GPC SEC GFC calibration. Michael?
Hello, good morning, good day, wherever you are. I would like to welcome you to the webinar. And the webinar today will be about GPC SEC GFC calibration. What you can see here on the first slide is an introduction, which will give you an idea of what are the topics I will talk about today. So the first topic is the introduction into the GPC SEC calibration. Then I want to talk about standard calibration with narrow distributed standards. So this is most likely the calibration technique you are using during the normal lab work. Afterwards, I want to show you the oligomer calibration. Then we have our self-evaluation test, where you can check if everything I presented so far is well understood. And after the self-evaluation, I will go on with the broad calibration and finish with the integral or cumulative match calibration. So this will be our topics today. And introduction to calibration. So what are we talking about if we hear the terms GPC, SEC, or GFC? So GPC is the abbreviation for gel permeation chromatography. SEC is size exclusion chromatography. GFC would be gel filtration chromatography. All these three abbreviations stand for the same technique. Personally, I like the size exclusion chromatography because this will already give you an idea what we are doing. We are separating according to size, more precisely to according to hydrodynamic volume. So the GPC, SEC, GFC is a pore size limited diffusion control liquid chromatography method. In contrast to HPLC, I don't want to have any interaction with the stationary phase. So I want to really separate my polymers according to the accessible pore volume in my column. So here is the separation mechanism. I have a GPC SEC column, which is filled with porous particles. And inside the particles, there are pores with different size. And the polymers can only go into the pores if the size fits. So if you go from left to right, on the left side, you see that you have different sizes of circles and different colors. So the color would be the chemistry, and the size would be the hydrodynamic radius. And the hydrodynamic radius is the hydrodynamic volume is the separation criteria for our polymers, and the separation that takes place onto the column. And it's easily understandable that if you have a certain pore size distribution, that the large molecules will not be able to penetrate into as many pores as the small molecules can do. So what happens if you inject your sample on the column? You get something like you see here on the right side. You have the so-called allogram. You inject your sample. First, you have a baseline, and then you see in this case, in this example, you will get three peaks. And you can see that the large molecules elute before the small molecules. So this would be your GPC. And you can also see that you will not be able to distinguish between the chemistry in this case. You are only separating according to the hydrodynamic volume. So why do we need calibration? Why do we have to do that? If we only inject a sample on the column and we do not do anything more, we will only get a chromatogram. So this is what you see here. You have the elution volume, you get a detector response, and that's it. But I want to somehow be able to compare samples not only visually, but more important by some characteristic numbers like number average and weight average. And in order to be able to do that, we need a calibration curve that connects the elution volume with the logarithm of the molar mass. And in the end, we are able to use our chromatogram and the calibration curve to transform the elution volume into molar mass and molar mass distributions. And we are able to calculate or use the WinGPC or any other software package to calculate the number average, weight average, centrifugal average of our polymer. And we are able to tell or say something about the distribution, whether it is broad or narrow distributed. So how to do the calibration? First of all, if you take a look at the narrow distributed standards that are used for calibration in this part of the webinar, you usually buy a standard, for example, in this case, a polystyrene with a polydispersity index of 1.04. So this is really a narrow distributed polymer. And then you see that there are three different numbers on the flask. This would be the MP value, the MW value, the MN value. So you know if you do GPC that you are interested in MN and MW values. And the MP value here, this is the one that you have to use for the calibration. If you take a look at your allogram, the MN and the MW values, these are average values, and they are most likely not on the highest point of your peak. So the only part of the chromatogram here that is clearly defined is the peak maximum, and you can assign easily the elution volume at the peak maximum to the MP value of your polymer. And this would correspond to the polymer fraction with the highest concentration. This is a value that is iteratively calculated, so you cannot measure it directly. This is how a calibration curve would look like. So first of all, we have two limits here. On the left side, we have the exclusion limit at 11.5 milliliter in this case. On the right side, we have the total penetration limit at about 19 milliliter elution volume. And the separation of your polymer takes place in the so-called pore volume, which is shown here in green. So the green part between the exclusion limit and total penetration limit would be the pore volume. And this is the volume used to separate your polymers. What you can also see is that the highest molar masses elute first and the small molar masses elute at the end. So this is what we already know. We have also the so-called interstitial volume here, starting from 0 milliliter going to 11.5. So this would be the volume that is available between the column particles. This is also something that you have to know. So this would be your so-called dead volume of the column. So this would be how the calibration curve looks like. What about the polymers? How do they look like in solution? So I would like to guide you through this slide. If you take a look at the left side, you have a polystyrene sample in different solvents. And here we have chloroform, THF, and if you go to cyclohexane or even more polar solvents, you can see that the same polymer is starting to behave completely different, meaning if you lower the solvent quality, your polymer starts to shrink and starts to avoid interaction with the solvent molecules. So the hydrodynamic volume changes from chloroform to THF to cyclohexane, and it's getting smaller. So you have to keep this in mind. And you can also easily understand, for example, if you measure polystyrene and you calibrate your system, for example, in chloroform, and afterwards you switch to THF and you measure polystyrene in THF, that you're definitely doing something wrong. So please do always use the same conditions for calibration as you use afterwards for the measurement. Meaning you use the same temperature of your column, the same flow rate, the same eluent, and if it's possible, you also use calibration standards that are chemically equal to your samples. Very often, this is unfortunately not the case. If you have different samples, you will get, nevertheless, molar masses, but these are molar masses based on the standard that you have used for calibration. If you take a look on the right side, you can see that if you have the same identical solvent and you dissolve polyisoprene, polystyrene, and PMMA in it, so this would be the case in THF, you see that the swelling behavior is completely different. If you now mix these three polymers, the polyisoprene, polystyrene, and PMMA together in one vial, and you inject this vial, you will only see one peak eluting from the column. You have three polymers, but the hydrodynamic volume is the same in this example, so you will only get one peak that is eluting from the column. And you can easily understand that it makes a difference if you calibrate your system with polyisoprene or with polystyrene or with PMMA. So what are standards available for systems? What do we have? So I would like to also guide you through this slide. And if you take a look at the upper left part of the slide, you see that you have a box with standard kits. So this is a standard kit box, meaning you have different molar masses, narrow distributed molar masses in each vial, and you can use these single standards to calibrate your system. You can even mix these standards to get two or three calibration points per inject. If you do not want to mix the standards on your own, you can also buy the so-called radical kit. This would be the box on the upper right part of the slide. In this case, you have a box with 10 vials in case of organic standards. In case of pululan, you have 5 vials. And with each series of vials, you can easily calibrate your system. The vials are color-coded. And each vial contains 4 different molar masses of your polymer. You can easily put solvent or eluent on top of it into your vial. You let it stand for a certain time. Starting from 1 million and above, you have to wait overnight. You dissolve your polymers, and then you can make 3 injects. Each vial contains 4 standards, so you will get 12 calibration points. We have standards for calibration available for organic systems. The most prominent ones are polystyrene and PMMA. We have also calibration standards for aqueous systems, polyethylene glycol, polyethylene oxide, or pululan. And we can also you can also buy standards for high temperature GPC, in this case polystyrene. If you are interested in customized standards, you can also ask PSS if we can do that for you. One thing that you have to think about is the concentration. So for standard calibration, you do not have to know, you do not have the exact concentration. But you must be in a region so that you can still measure the standards very well, meaning if you take a look at molar masses of 1 million and above and you create a concentration of, let's say, 10 gram per liter, then you have a much too high concentration. the viscosity will not allow this sample or the standard to elute in GPC mode from the column. So please keep in mind, if you have molar masses above 1 million, use only a concentration of 0.5 gram per liter or less. In all other cases, meaning below 1 million, you can have 1 to 2 gram per liter or milligram per milliliter. If you examine samples with a broad molar mass distribution, you will in fact fractionate your sample onto the column, so you can go up to higher concentrations, meaning 4 to 5 milligram per milliliter. And if you have very, very high molar masses, you might want to reduce the concentration with raising molar mass. Another thing that is important is the injection volume. What should you use for what? So if you have only one column, 20 microliter is fine. With two columns, you can use 50. With three columns, 100 microliter, and 4 to 5 columns, you can inject 200 to 250 microliters of injection volume. So this would be the radical standard. Remember, you have four different molar masses in one vial. So this would be the inject here, and you can directly see you get four elution rooms, which you can assign to four molar masses that are in the radical vial, and you can get 4 points with one inject. So this is really convenient. If you create a calibration curve, keep in mind that you have to calibrate over the whole elution volume. So you have to cover the whole elution volume of your column, and you should use 2 to 3 standards per molar mass decade. And of course, the pairs elution volume molar mass must be evenly distributed over the elution volume of your column. So this would be the calibration curve. When you start to create your calibration curve, you start with a calibration table. You have the pairs, elution volume, molar mass. You can directly see from the sample name that you get really four molar masses per vial. So here you see this would be a start of a calibration curve, not yet finished, because at the moment you have only discrete points. You can see that the fit function is currently none here. So there's no fit function. So what you have to do is first choose the right fit function, and how to choose the correct fit function. How can we do that? So first of all, there is no theoretical best fit function available. So you have to do some trial and error here. But fortunately, the WinGPC can help you to decide if you have chosen a good or a bad calibration curve. So remember, in the beginning, you have discrete points, discrete pairs, elution volume, molar mass. As soon as you create a calibration curve, you will get some deviation from the measured points to the points that you can calculate afterwards with the calibration curve. And these so-called residues should be statistically distributed, and they should be small. So that's the first thing you have to keep in mind. The calibration curve should be physically meaningful. So you should always check the slope of the calibration curve and check the derivative here. And there's also something like the regression coefficient, which is well known to people coming from HPLC. I can already tell you that the regression coefficient is not really sensitive in order to decide if you have a good or a bad calibration curve. If you absolutely want to focus on this R value, you should be at least a bit above 0.999, but we have much better decision criteria available here. So first of all, if you take a look here at the calibration curve, so this would be the measure points would be the light green dots. So these are the discrete points. The green line would be your calibration curve. In this case, I have a polynomial function of 5 as fit function, and the dark green dots will indicate here the deviation of the measured point from the point calculated from your calibration curve. We can see here that we have a deviation between -7 to +6%. So we might want to try a higher fit function like polynomial function 7. In this case, you will see that the deviation of your measured points will be much smaller. So you might think and argue that it's always good to use a very high polynomial fit function, but you also have to keep in mind that you should also think about your calibration curve, if it's physically meaningful or not. So in this case, if you take a look at the slope, you see that you have some uneven changes here. In the region where you go into the direction of the total exclusion limit or total penetration limit, you have a steep calibration curve. This is normal because you have low resolution here. So steep calibration curve means low resolution. But you want to have an even change of the calibration curve of the slope, like it's shown here on the next slide. Here you only have the fit function, polynomial function 5, and you see this looks much better. So you have still the steep slope in the extreme ends of your column, but you see that you have a steady derivative over the illusion volume of your column. So this looks much better, and this would be the right fit function here. Here is a mixture of 4 polystyrenes shown onto 2 different column sets. You can see 2 things here. The calibration curves are completely different. So you can easily imagine that you have to calibrate for each column set that you use, you have to calibrate first. So you cannot use a calibration curve that you have established with another column set, with the new column set. You always have to recalibrate the columns that you are currently using. That's the first thing. Second thing is, you can see in both allograms you have 2 red dots. And the 2 red dots would be the endpoint of your calibration. You are only inside the calibrated range between these 2 red dots. So this is the lowest and the highest molar mass that you have used for your calibration. You can see that if you are outside the, this region, this calibrated region, the calibration curve is extrapolated and you get only molar masses with extrapolation. So this is not really precise here. So keep in mind, stay, if possible, between the 2 red dots here, so the lowest and the highest molar mass. As I already mentioned before, a steep calibration curve indicates low resolution because you have a large molar mass range in a small illusion volume. On the other side, if you have a very flat calibration curve, you can get a very high resolution, and with the correct porosity, you can even see that something has happened here with the standard in the low molar mass region. You see that you have more than one peak. And what is the reason is shown here on the next slides. So I will now go to the Yerlinger calibration before we start with our self-evaluation test. Oligomer recalibration, what are the requirements? I must know my structure, the structure that I'm using for calibration. I must know the homologous N-mer series of my standard, And I must have, of course, an adequate resolution of the column. This is what we have seen before on the slide. If I do not have the proper resolution, I will not be able to get my oligomers separated sufficiently well. How do I implement my oligomer calibration? First of all, I have to measure an oligomer example. Then I have to analyze my homolog model substance. And then I can use my model substance to assign the oligomer homologs to the correct molar mass. So here would be the example, anionic polymerization of polystyrene. I start with a tertiary butyl starter group, which has 57 Daltons. Every styrene monomer unit will add 104 Daltons. And I have to quench the reaction with the addition of alcohol, so I protonate my growing center, and if I calculate, I get a molar mass of 162. This would be my polystyrene with polymerization degree of 1. And phenylhexane would be a suitable model substance here with 162 Daltons. I can inject, and by comparison of the retention volume, I can assign the P1 to the correct peak. And this is what I'm showing here on my last slide before the self-evaluation. We now see here the oligomer example a bit larger than before on the previous slide. And you would, for example, see that the phenylhexane elutes at 32.3 milliliter. So you can easily assign the peak here at 32.3 milliliter to P1. So this would be the molar mass of 162. The P2 would be 266. So you just add one styrene unit with 104 Dalton, P3 would be 370, and so on. And at the end, you end up with a calibration curve, which is here shown on the right side. So the elution volume between below 23 milliliter would be the peaks that you get from the normal polymer calibration. And above 23 milliliters, you get the points directly from your oligomer sample. So this is one polystyrene, but very well, you have a very, very good resolution here on the column set. And in this case, you can create up to 9 different pairs, elution volume, molar mass for the addition to the standard calibration curve. So now it's time for the self-evaluation, and I would like to pass the microphone to my colleague Derek Lohmann, who will do the self-evaluation with you. And I will come back after the self-evaluation test. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
So just that we're not making any mistakes here, the webinar will continue after the self-evaluation, so don't go anywhere. Just bear with me for the self-evaluation part. Like I said, this is relatively new for 2016. So question is, if you have a polyethylene oxide on a Suprema medium column set, which has a separation range of 100 to 1 million Dalton, which calibration kit would you use? And obviously, there's only one answer that is correct. Which would you use? The polystyrene kit, ranging from 500 to 2.5 million. A dextran kit from 180 to 400,000. A polyolan kit from 180 to 708,000. A polyolan kit from 180 to 1.2 million, or a polyethylene glycol polyethylene oxide kit ranging from 200 to 996,000 Dalton. I'm going to wait a little bit. The results of this poll will be displayed later on, but just in percentages, so don't be scared that your individual result will be shown. It's just an anonymous percentage value that's shown. So the polls are open. And we're going to give it another few seconds, I'm thinking, for you to digest what you're seeing here and see if we can get a little more representative results from hopefully not all of you, but at least I'm always aiming for 80%, and we're not just quite there yet. So again, obviously only one answer is correct. And I think this is about good enough. So let me share the results of this first question with you. So probably out of habit, a lot of people selected the polystyrene ReadyCal kit for that task, but obviously polyethylene oxide usually is run in aqueous media, so polystyrene is not really the polymer of choice. The other ones all can be used, but obviously the best fit, and 60% of you decided on that, is using a polyethylene oxide, polyethylene glycol mixture covering almost the complete range of the selected column set. It's important to not only calibrate in the region where you think your polymer may be in terms of size, but it's rather important to calibrate over the whole separation range of the column set. That's why that polyethylene glycol, polyethylene oxide ReadyCal kit is the best option. So question number two, when you're preparing solutions for a calibration, you must pay attention to 1 to 5 of the following facts, so you can actually select as many as you like. No molar mass mixtures can be used. Do single injections. You need very precise concentrations. You have to weigh in the solvent. High molar mass standards require long dissolution times. High molar mass standards require high concentrations. And the concentration for samples and standards have to be equal. Like I said, you can choose as many as you like, but please choose at least one, because we're thinking we actually sneaked in one right answer at least, or so I'm hoping. And the question is, when you're doing a calibration, what are the things you have to pay attention to? Don't use molar mass mixtures, only do single injections. Use very precise concentrations. You have to weigh in the solvent. High molar mass standards require long dissolution times. High molar mass standards require high concentrations. And the last door, door number E, concentration for samples and standards have to be equal. We're going to give it another minute or so here so that everybody has a chance in participating. So I'm going to close the poll now and we'll share the results with you. 70% of you got the actually only right answer. High molar mass standards require long dissolution times. Problem is, obviously, the longer a polymer chain gets, the more time it takes for the polymer coil to dissolve completely in the solvent and reach its equilibrium state. A lot of people also selected very precise concentrations are required, weigh in solvent. That is not necessary for conventional calibration. It would, however, be necessary if you were to do if you had your system hyphenated to a light scattering detector or a viscosity detector, and would be doing universal calibration, or like I said, an absolute determination of molar mass using light scattering, because for that you need to have the absolute and correct concentration. It's not necessarily important that you have the concentration for samples and standards equal. The only thing that you should be paying attention to, and Michael mentioned that in his slides, is that obviously you shouldn't be overloading your column, so make sure you use the right concentration. Use lower concentrations for higher molar masses due to viscosity effects, and make sure that you scale up or down your injection volume with the amount of columns that you're using. And the next question we have is regarding the fits in the or the fit of the calibration curve. A linear fit has a regression coefficient of R=0.9987. What's your next step? Repeat the analysis. The data is not precise enough. Save the calibration and use it. The fit function is good. Select polynomial 3. If R is 0.999, then the fit function is good. Or select a higher order polynomial, check first derivative. So again, the task is, you did your calibration, or you put in the points for your calibration curve. You're letting the math do its thing with a linear fit, and you're looking at the regression coefficient, and it says 0.9987. Question is, do you repeat the analysis because the data is not good enough? Do you save the calibration because you think that's a very good fit? Do you select a polynomial 3, and if it's 0.999, and the fit function, you determine the fit function good and go with it? Or do you select a higher order polynomial and check the first derivative? So I'm going to give it a few more seconds. And I'm going to share the results with you. So the correct answer is D. Select a higher order polynomial and check the first derivative. Because as Michael explained, when looking at the first derivative, and I think we can have a look at that slide once more later on, it's important that you don't have, let's say, ups and downs in the first derivative, but that it's a smooth progression indicating the range where you can actually do a good, or where your calibration curve fits correctly to the points that you're having. This may actually be a third order polynomial, but you will only know for sure if you are able to check the first derivative of the calibration curve. I would never ever just assume by looking at the regression coefficient that a calibration curve and that a fit is good and we're going with it. I'll take it that most of you decided that we need a higher order polynomial, as in a polynomial 3. But like I said, you will get the best information out of checking the first derivative of your fit that you were using. And now on to the last question of the day. Which statements about calibration curves are true? Please check all that apply. At least 2 to 3 standards per molar mass decade are required. use the same fit function for the same column type. Linear calibration curves are more precise. You're changing the pre-column, does that require a recalibration? And replacement of old solvent requires recalibration. So, and like I said, after this self-evaluation is over, Michael has, I'd say, some more advanced calibration techniques that he would also like to show you. So don't run away, bear with us for the rest of the webinar. Also, we'll be having a question and answer session at the end of the webinar. So if there's questions regarding calibration, you're more than welcome to ask those using the questions tab in the GoToMeeting app or program or whatever you want to call it. And as a reminder again, at the end of the webinar, Michael will be displaying our email addresses. If you have either further questions or if you would like to have a PDF of the slides or would like to have access to the recording of the webinar so you can either replay it or share it with your colleagues or whatever it is that you want to do with it. Save it for further reference, maybe. Again, this is about what is true about calibration. And I'm going to leave this open for just a few more seconds. So here are the results. Obviously, most of you got correct. Yes, you need 2 to 3 standards per molar mass decade to make a good fit function, because obviously if you only had one standard per molar mass decade, that would definitely be too little to cover the separation range of your column set. And also, when you're exchanging the pre-column, that requires recalibration. Why is that, you would ask? Because it's only a tiny pre-column and it should not contribute to separation at all. Well, to a very small extent, it does contribute to the separation. And like with all columns, they are packed individually, so they differ in terms of their packing, which also means that the retention times that you'll be achieving, even if you have the same column set, can shift either to slightly lower or slightly higher retention times, and therefore you need to have a recalibration when you're exchanging the pre-column to make sure that you take those small deviations by exchanging the pre-column or guard column into account. When you replace old solvent, you don't need to recalibrate. However, if you put your column set in a different solvent, so let's say you're running your SDV columns in THF and then you switch to toluene, obviously that requires a recalibration as outlined by Michael, because one polymer will have a different size in solution if you have a different solvent. So that's why you always need to recalibrate when you exchange one solvent for another. But if you're just exchanging one batch of THF with a new batch of THF, you don't need to recalibrate. And with that, I guess I will be hiding those poles again and will give the mic back over the Atlantic Ocean to Michael.
Yes, it's me. Hello again. So I will now continue with the webinar. So you have now, you were now able to evaluate yourself with the self-evaluation. I hope you had a lot of fun. It was really nice for me to listen to all the results. Very interesting. So I will now continue with the broad calibration and last but not least with integral calibration. So why do you want to do a broad calibration? This can be a useful technique if you have, for example, problems that substances that you want to use for calibration are not available as narrow standards, or you cannot use the Mark-Cowing coefficients K and alpha. So you cannot do the mathematical universal calibration by calculating the intrinsic viscosities. So this would be the interesting things here to do broad calibration. And here is the broad calibration, how this technique works. So the easiest thing is to imagine first a linear calibration curve. Of course, we all know that we never use linear calibration curves with GPC. At least I have never seen a column that I can use in conjunction with linear calibration with GPC. So most of the time you have higher order fit functions. But just to illustrate how the broad calibration works, this is very well suited. So you need one sample which is broad distributed, meaning pole dispersity index above 1.5, and you need MN and MW values here. As soon as you have the MN and MW value from your broad sample, you also know the pole dispersity. And if you take a look how the broad calibration works, you see that obviously you must have your allogram of your broad sample. And somehow you must adjust the linear calibration curve in a way that you first rotate it and then you can shift it up or down. So why do you have to do that? So first of all, imagine if you have a calibration curve, or in this case linear calibration with a slope of zero. This means every elution volume element is connected to the same molar mass. So this would be, if you have at early elution volumes the same molar mass, you would have a monodispersed substance. Of course, we do not have this monodispersed substance here because we have a broad sample. So in the first step, we rotate the linear calibration curve in a way that we get the correct PDI of the broad sample, which is defined by the MW divided by MN. So this would be the first step. Then we will see that we will most likely not have the correct MN and W values. If they are too small, we have to shift the calibration curve up. If they are too large or too big, we have to shift the calibration curve down until we find the correct MN and W values of our broad sample. So this is the technique that is behind. In case of the linear calibration. More precise is the calibration curve, which is based on method 2, because in this case you are not limited to a linear calibration curve, meaning you calibrate your column set with a standard. You can use every standard that you like just to get the basic calibration curve of your system. So basic calibration curve of any polymer type would be the requirement, and you need one or more broad samples where you have to know the exact MW or MN or intrinsic viscosity value. Both polymers, meaning the polymer that you use for calibration and the broad sample, must follow the universal calibration, meaning you have elution of the samples of the standards in pure GPC mode. This is how the broad calibration works in WinGPC. You have your basic calibration curve. In this case, it's a polystyrene calibration curve, and you measure your broad sample where you know the MN or MW or intrinsic viscosity value. You get the allogram, and then you can tell WinGPC, please use the calibration curve, the existing one, in this case polystyrene, and use the allogram and use the defined MN or MW values that you have to know in order to adjust the calibration curve in a way that you find the correct MN and W values of the standard. So This was the broad calibration we have seen with method number one. We have only the possibility to use one sample, and we can only use linear calibration curves. In addition, we must know MN and MW, and this can be sometimes difficult to get from one sample, MN and MW, because either you have a high molar mass where you can get MW very easily from light scattering, but then you have problems with the determination of MN. On the other side, MN can easily be measured in the low molar mass region, for example, with osmometric measurements, but then you will not be able to get a good MW value from light scattering. It's mathematically easy. Method number two is the one which is chosen by WinGPC. So you create the calibration curve which connects the elution volume to the molar mass, which already gives you the information about the porosity distribution of the column. And then you can use two, three, or even more broad samples to adjust the calibration curve, the existing one, with the broad samples. And in this case, you must either know MW or MN or the intrinsic viscosity. And very often, MW and the intrinsic viscosity can very precisely determined with measurements. However, it's very difficult in a mathematical point of view. But fortunately, we can use our software and let the computer do at least the calculation work here. So the last topic is now the integral or cumulative match calibration. What requirements do we need here? We need a broad sample where we know the integral distribution, meaning we must have a list, and the list consists of weight percent and corresponding molar mass. We need the allogram of the broad sample of the on the column set that we want to calibrate. And as a potential application, we have the possibility to calibrate the column set with only one sample. But the same restrictions apply here as to the normal standard calibration. The sample must cover the complete elution volume of the column. And this is how it looks like. You have your integral standard and you have the list. If 10% of the sample has eluted from the column, this corresponds to molar mass of 26,900. 30% corresponds to 55,100, and so on. And what you can do is, you measure your sample, you have your allogram, and then you can check. 60% would be here. You see, this would be the point when this mass, this weight percentage has eluted from the column. You can read the elution volume and you can assign the molar mass to this elution volume. So it's the same thing that you do with the standard calibration. But here you only do it with one sample, and this is a very convenient way to calibrate the column or the column set that you want to use. This is how it looks like with the integral calibration. You have your chromatogram, your allogram, and you can see here on the slide there's a button, open file, where the table with molar mass, percentage of molar mass versus molar mass is stored. And then you can get your discrete points, elution volume, molar mass, and you can choose your fit function like you have done it before with the standard calibration technique. So this would be just a slide to show you a little bit what you have to keep in mind for all calibration techniques that were discussed so far. So you have a lowest, you always have a lowest and a highest molar mass. And this would be the endpoints of your calibration curve, meaning your column is only calibrated in between these two molar masses. That's one thing that you have to keep in mind. The second thing that you have to keep in mind, if you take a look at different polymers, they can be either different in a chemical point of view or due to architecture, you will see that the calibration curves will not be on top of each other. So it's a difference, it makes a difference if you use PMMA or polystyrene for calibration. And this is true for all calibrations that we have seen so far, standard oligomer calibration, broad and integral calibration. So the conclusions, all calibrations describe the relationship between dilution volume and the molecular weight based on the standard that you use. In all calibration types, the calibration depends on chemical structure, and it also depends on the polymer topology. So a linear polymer will behave differently compared to a branched one or a comb structure. And you will establish the calibration curve by measuring different standards and assign the elution volume to the molar mass at this elution volume. You have two endpoints, smallest and the highest molar mass, and only the volume in between is the calibrated range of the column. Outside, the molar masses are extrapolated. Last slide, to give you some idea what other techniques are available. Very briefly, you can use a light scattering detector to get the absolute molar masses. You can use a universal calibration, in this case, either calculate the intrinsic viscosity based on Mercalli coefficients. If you do not have them, you can use a viscosity detector to make real measurements of intrinsic viscosities. Mass spectrometry is also something that you have to keep in mind if you talk about absolute molar masses. And last but not least, if you have, for example, refractive index detector and UV detector, and you make the analysis of copolymers, you can determine the response factor of each detector on each comonomer, and from both homo calibration curves of the homopolymer, the copolymer calibration curve can be calculated, and you can also get for copolymers MN and MW values. So that's it. I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope that you have a lot of ideas what you can now do in the lab, to what you can do in the case of other calibration techniques. And if you have any questions, we can now start to answer some of them. So I will give the microphone to my colleague Derek Lohmann now. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, for this interesting presentation, and thank you, everybody, for sticking with us. So one thing I'd like to point out briefly, because Michael didn't mention it, the integral calibration method based on the sliced data for different percentages of a broad standard is actually the method that is used in the United States Pharmacopoeia for heparin analysis. So if any of you are in the pharmaceutical field, this is exactly the method that you need to use if you want to determine the molar mass of heparins in a GPC method. So one question we have now is regarding the calibration curves. The question is, since we talked about a linear fit and then we talked about polynomials, what about using exponential functions for correlating mass with elution volume? So if you mean by exponential that it has an exponent, that is exactly what we're doing. So a third order polynomial obviously is something with x to the third, and that's something that you do, and maybe Michael can talk a little bit more about which exponents we like to use and which we don't like to use and where you should be paying attention.
So, first of all, if you take a look at the exponents, you should use at least exponent 3. This is my experience. If you go to higher exponential fit functions, for example, exponent 7, then you will see that you get very small deviation of your measured points from the calibration curve, but very often you will also see that you do not have a steady change of the slope. So most of the time you end up with exponential functions of 3 or 5. If you take a look at exponential function with exponent 4, this is not best way, because you always have these S-shaped calibration curves, and they are symmetrically to a point. So exponential function 3 or 5 is usually the right, either two of them are the right exponential function to use for the calibration curve. But of course, you always have to keep in mind the slope, and this is what you should always check. I hope this answers the question.
I'm sure it does, Michael. One other thing I want to add is, while some softwares, including ours, also give you the option of a seventh order polynomial, really what you're doing there is, and Michael said that already, you are fitting your errors to the curve rather than fitting your curve to your column set. So choose, like Michael said, look at the first derivative, but choose as small an exponent as you can and stick with the odd ones, because like Michael pointed out, the even ones, so the second power, fourth power, usually don't make a whole lot of sense. Now the question, that's an interesting question. When replacing an existing column, is it necessary to use a correction factor for MN and MW of the sample? I wouldn't even say you should be using a correction factor. If you are replacing an existing column, what you do is you do a completely new calibration with the new column set, because like we pointed out in the self-evaluation, whenever you change one column, even as small as a guard column, you are changing the retention volume of your samples due to slight differences in packing of the columns. Also, if you are, for example, using a new tubing connector between either the columns or the detector or wherever, you are also changing the elution volume of your samples. So that needs to be taken into account when you run your calibration. So whenever you replace, let's say, any part in your system, so if you are, like I said, replacing a piece of tubing, you're adding another detector, you are changing column A for column B, always do a complete new calibration. There's no way, and that's actually your correction factor. I mean, you could then compare, technically, your old calibration curve to your new calibration curve, but the best and sound way is using a new calibration. Michael, any additions to that?
No, I think I couldn't have said that better. As soon as you exchange the column, you might have small differences in the porosity distribution, so you have to recalibrate. If you only exchange a capillary, you can try to determine the difference of the two capillaries, and you might be able to shift every elution volume by the same amount. But this is only possible in case of changing the capillaries. But nevertheless, it might be the easier way to just recalibrate.
Well, and then the question is, sorry for chuckling, but this is actually, I like that. What is the error introduced by using a linear fit with, so that goes back to our self-evaluation, 0.9987 instead of a higher fit with 0.999? And honestly, the answer is it depends, because it depends on what your column, what the best fit for the column set that you're currently using actually is. So if you have a mixed bed column, which usually is built in such a way that you have as close to a linear calibration as possible, you may actually get a better fit with the linear regression than you would get with a higher order polynomial. But if you have a set of single porosity columns, that actually really depends on, and that's why Michael and I emphasized that you have to look at the first derivative of your calibration curve. That should be your key go-to sign. If you look at the first derivative and it looks wavy or strange, then your fit is not good and you should be using a different fit. There's no number you can put on that. And then the next two questions actually more or less are the same. Nicely and long elaborately asked, what are the typical deviations in values between actual masses for standards and points calculated using a good calibration curve? And simpler asked, what is the precision of SEC? So I would say on any given day, if you use your system and your system only, you run your samples on your exact column set, you do your calibration relatively often, make sure that you add a flow marker to spot and correct small deviations in the flow precision coming from the pump, you can probably get below 5%. If you compare the same column set with the same system and even the same method at two different labs, let's say one in, I don't know, let's stick with the US, one in Texas and one up here in Massachusetts, I'd say it's safe to say that if you are below 10%, then you're actually good. Michael, what's your experience with reproducibility or deviation of SEC?
So the numbers I have in mind, if you are only talking about standard calibration, 5%, you can do that, but then you must have a system that is running really well. So you will not be able to get the first or the second digit after the comma. I think that's clear. So it's not mass spectroscopy, but 5 to 10% for standard calibration is the error margin that you have. And of course, you can always make other errors. For example, if the pump is not working reliably, or you're using different standards, somebody has calibrated his GPC system with polystyrene, the other one with PMMA. If you want to compare then the molar masses, you will see that you have larger deviations in this case. So I would say in the best case, you can get below 5%, 5%, but you can also get, of course, larger deviations here.
Right. And then the question is deviation between, well, actual masses and of the standards and the point calculated. The question is also, what type of polymer are you using? Because if you have, let's say you calibrate with polystyrene, but your polymer is something entirely different from polystyrene, then obviously the molar mass of that sample will not necessarily match the molar mass of the polystyrene calibration. However, it will always match the polystyrene calibration. So if you always base your molar mass calculation on relative GPC based on polystyrene, you will always get within the 5 to 10% error margin that we just talked about, you will get that. And I guess, in terms of questions, I think that's about it. If you have more questions, don't hesitate to shoot either Michael or myself an email. We're more than happy to help you out. Also, if you would like to have a copy of the webinar, in PDF or the link to the streaming video, shoot us an email. We're more than happy to help you out. And then I guess from me in beautiful Amherst, Massachusetts, we're approaching, I think, 75 degrees Fahrenheit, 23 Celsius today. So it's too bad I have to sit in the office. It's a wonderful good morning, good day, good night, wherever in the world you joined us. And I will leave the last words to Michael.
Yeah, hello, it's me, the final last words. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope that we hear each other soon in the next webinar or maybe also per email. So have a nice rest of the week and a nice rest of the day. And goodbye. See you next time. Goodbye.